Good evening, everyone. I'm Julia O'Hara, Assistant Director for Communications with USF Housing and Residential Education. And I'm here with Ana Hernandez, Assistant Vice President of Housing and Residential Education here at USF. And we're here to review some housing information and answer any questions you have about living on campus. So before we get started with some questions and topics I have prepared, I want to encourage everyone watching to type their questions in the comments on either Facebook or YouTube, depending on where you're watching. Or in Microsoft Teams app if you're here with us in the app. So I'll be reading your questions from social media or in the app to Ana as we go through our broadcast. So let's get started. How are you, Ana?
I'm great. Thanks so much for asking. And yourself?
I'm good, thank you. Trying to stay warm on this chilly day here in Tampa.
I know. Is it too early to say I'm done with winter?
Luckily, us Floridians don't have to deal with it for very long, so that's nice that there's an end coming soon, I'm sure. All right, so I am so excited for tonight because we already have a question from a viewer. Buddha, thank you so much for your question, for tuning in on the Parent and Family Engagement Facebook page. Let's get started with a question from the audience. How do you sign up to save a spot for freshman housing?
Great, thank you so much for the question. So we are excited that we recently launched the student housing agreement for both the summer and the fall. And so that is available on the housing at the housing website. So student, when they're admitted, can go to the housing portal and submit their $50 application fee as well as their student housing agreement. And we haven't opened up selection for selecting the particular rooms. That for new students, that probably won't happen until the middle of March. But it's great to get your application in and you know, sort of get queued up in the line. There's a couple of other things that will need to happen before the March selection process. So once you apply, you pay your application fee, you would need to submit your immunization requirements, and you can go to Student Health Services and they will indicate to you what is required with regard to immunizations. And then once the orientation sessions open, then you would register for orientation. And so this submitting student housing agreement, paying the application fee, registering for orientation and submitting your immunization, that all sets you up in order to be able to select your room when we open up that selection process in March.
Great, thank you for that answer. And I've just posted the URL to the housing portal directly so that students that are watching can sign up. So the, like you said, the fall spring application is open and we will have summer open very soon. We're hoping to get that application up as soon as possible.
Yep.
And Buddha has another question as a follow-up. How do you know if a student is eligible for Honors College housing? So I'm referring to the Living Learning community.
Right, so we have several Living Learning communities. The one you're specifically referring to is the Honors College, which is housed in Juniper Hall here on campus. And so there's a separate Living Learning community application process. And so that's what I would encourage if your student has been admitted to the Honors College, that they would submit that Living Learning community application. We then work with our colleagues in the Honors College that basically are our academic partners for the Living Learning communities, and then they will send us an approved roster, and then students are able to select those rooms. But again, that the selection process won't happen until March.
Great. And just to review, I have the room selection dates here in front of me for those watching. Right now we have for fall spring 21-22 room selection dates for continuing USF students. So whether they are a current resident or not, if you are a USF student, room selection will become available in mid-February. We're going to be announcing that date in a little bit, in a couple of weeks probably. And then room selection for new students, we have opening on March 10th right now. And then for summer, there is a different date for all students. Room selection will begin on March 17th. I will drop a link to the application process webpage here and all of these feeds so that everyone can review those dates and be prepared, but definitely apply as soon as possible so that you have the best chance for selecting the room that you would like.
And I do need to say, Julia, just because of the last 8 months, everything is subject to change. So that is the calendar and that is the schedule that we have as of now. We are hoping to be able to stay connected with that. But if there's any change, then we would certainly be making an announcement. But mid-February for continuing and returning students, and then March 10th for new students.
Absolutely. Thank you for that, Anna. So we've covered some highlights about the housing application in general, room selection. For those that are watching, if you have any additional questions about that, please send them in and we can answer them here on the show. But there are two big things that we're focused on here in housing coming up. One is wrapping up for the fall semester, and then the next is preparing for the spring opening. So next I'm gonna switch gears and start asking some questions about fall closing. But like I said, for anybody watching, if you have any questions about anything related to housing, please send in those questions, or not related to housing. Maybe we can point you in the right direction for any questions you have related to USF. So for fall closing, let's talk about when do the residence halls close for winter break? We're really coming up on those dates.
We are. So the halls close, well, students are supposed to vacate their rooms 24 hours after their last final. The last date that residents would be in the halls would be by noon on December 11th. That's when we close most of the residence halls and the apartments here on campus in order to prepare for the winter break. We do have an option for winter break housing, but students would have had to apply for that already, and those students will be staying in Horizon Hall and the Holly Apartments. And so December 11th at noon is when we're expecting the halls to be emptying out.
Great, thank you. And we have all this information on our closing webpage, but let's review what steps both returning and those that may be graduating and not returning students should take before they leave the halls.
Okay, I'm going to start with those who are returning in the spring, because that certainly is our vast majority of residents. Just in preparation, so acknowledging that students are going to be away from campus for an extended period of time, we want to make sure that students have packed everything that they think that they're going to need. Some usual things that people forget is glasses, contacts, medication. Sometimes they forget their laptop, you know, because they're thinking, okay, my classes are over, but people use their laptop for other things. Clothes that they may need, especially if there is a climate change. So making sure that they're bringing jackets or whatever it is that they may not be wearing to the airport, but they're going to need when they arrive wherever they land. And so we just want to make the other thing is adapters and power cords. So sometimes students forget their phone chargers or their earphones or whatever it may be. So just really think about what is it that you think that you're going to need for the next month or so. In order to prepare the space, we want to make sure that students have removed all of their perishable food, that anything that's remaining in their rooms has been sealed. If it is that they have items in the refrigerator, we recommend that they empty them out just because it's been because they'll be there for a month so that they don't have any surprises when they return. And if they have small microfridge units, not the big apartment refrigerators, but microfridge units, then emptying them out and allowing them to defrost is always a good idea. We usually recommend that they do that 24 to 48 hours in advance to make sure that they don't return with a big puddle in front of their door. So And we want to make sure that the other piece is that if for some reason there is an empty space in a student's room, like they have a double and one roommate has moved out, or they haven't had a roommate over the course of the time period, we want to make sure that the students have cleaned the space up, basically, and have left the space in a way that they would want to return to a room if they were brand new. So first impressions matter. And so making sure that the other half of the room is completely empty of the other roommate's personal belongings and those kinds of things. And so really just trying to be hospitable in that regard. If a student is not returning for the spring, they're graduating, which we have a virtual graduation that's scheduled for this weekend, or something similar, then we want to make sure that the student has notified Housing and Residential Education, so submitted their cancellation request, letting us know what that is, and then making sure that they returned their keys to the Housing Services office. If it is that they're leaving after hours, they do have the ability to return their keys by mail as long as we receive them by noon on December 11th. If it is students that are mailing keys back, we absolutely want to make sure that students are using padded envelopes because if not, then lost keys may happen in the mail in the transit. And unless we receive them, then they'll be counted as the keys not being returned, and then there's going to be subject to lock changes and those types of things. So there's more prepping for your room if you're returning in the spring so that everything is ready for someone to return, but happy to answer any other questions people may have.
Thanks, Anna, and also that address to send back your keys. If mailing in your key is something that you want to do, that's listed on the fall closing webpage under the mail-in key option, and I've posted that on all of the places that we're going live right now. So if anyone needs that address or any of the other information, they can review it on the webpage. We haven't gotten any additional questions about the fall closing, so I just wanted to take a moment to see if there's anything else related to fall before we transition into spring that we need to remind our audience of, or any tips. I'm pulling up the webpage now to see if there's anything that I can offer here. I think one of the things is the COVID-19 protocol. Would you like to go over just the general protocol that we follow on campus with the mask wearing and social distancing for those that are having people come and help them move out?
Sure. So we really try to create a safe environment, and that goes all the way through the end of the semester. And so we're limiting the number of people that would be able to enter the hall. Our preference really is that we wouldn't have anybody coming into the hall that has not been a resident of that space for a long period of time. But we know that if you're moving everything out, then you may need some additional assistance, and we would just ask you to do that as quickly as possible. Anybody that's in our residence halls or on campus is expected to wear masks at all times, unless you're, you know, behind your own personal room door, that you maintain 6 feet distance. And part of that, as it relates to move out, usually occurs when you're in an elevator. So if you're not part of the same family unit, then what we would ask is that if somebody's already in the elevator, you just wait for the next elevator. Or if you're in the elevator and somebody tries to get on, please just politely ask them to wait for the next elevator to come about. We always recommend that students are washing their hands regularly throughout the process, and so we'd like any of our guests to do that as well. So, you know, it's terrible to go into either finishing your finals or go into a holiday season having to go through a quarantine or an isolation process. And so everything that we can do to keep students and their families safe throughout the process is really important to us.
Thank you, Anna. We have a question from a viewer. If there's a particular pass that a resident would need to have medication with them in housing, and they're not sure if they need documentation? If you are at USF for several semesters, do we change housing dorms? So the first part of that question is needing a pass, and then.
Sure. I was going to say those are two different questions. So let me ask. Yeah. Let me answer the first one about medication. So there isn't anything that is required specifically for housing and residential education for students to have their own prescription medication, et cetera. We always recommend that students keep their medication in the prescription bottles that have their names on them, et cetera. One of the things, if it is that a student's on a regular medication, they have the ability to transfer those prescriptions to the USF pharmacy. So that they'll have easy access to refilling those prescriptions. We also have several large chain pharmacies that are in and around campus. So you're able to do that as well, because we always want students to make sure that they have access to the medication that they need. Students can also go to the student health services to receive any medication that they may need there, or if they need an updated prescription, they can get a doctor's appointment to try to get that. So I hope that's the question that's being asked. If not, I'll try to get some additional information.
Yeah, I think that is. And then I think the second part of the question is an additional question. If you are at USF for several semesters, do we change your housing? So, if you're here for the fall spring and then you sign for the next fall spring, do you have the opportunity to stay in your room, or do you select a new room?
Yeah. So the answer is that we do our housing assignments based on term. So the contract period or the student housing agreement period, I'll use this year as an example, would go from August through May. That would be the term for the fall-spring contract, which is what most of our students are on. So you would be assigned to a space in August, and then you would move out of that space in May. You don't need to change in between semesters. We also have students that arrive in the spring, and so their student housing agreement would go from January until May. So everybody moves out in May. We also have selected residence halls that are open during the summer. And then the summer period, we have the start period of those agreements that start at various times over the course of the summer, depending on whether somebody's taking classes in term summer A, summer B, summer C, et cetera. And so the summer would be its own unique assignment. It is rare for a student to have the ability to stay from fall to spring to summer to fall to spring to summer all in the same space, because we open and close buildings over the course of the summer. So the general answer is you will stay in the same space or the same room assignment during the course of the term of your contract.
That's very helpful. Thank you, Anna. Glenda, the person who asked the question, says thank you very much. So thanks for that. Now that we have gone through the fall closing, thank you for everyone tuning in. Be sure to ask any questions you have in the comments. We'll continue answering your questions as we go through the broadcast. Right now, we'll transition to spring opening. We'll go over some basic information for spring opening, and I'll drop the link for that webpage so you can review it. And if you have any questions about the webpage as we go along, just ask in the comments. So Anna, the first question, let's talk about when is spring opening and what is the process this semester? So what do residents need to do, whether you're returning or you're brand new to campus? What does everyone need to do for this spring opening?
Great. So So there's lots of pieces to that. So I'll try to just do it in segments and then take a breath and see if what I've said makes sense. But I do want to refer everybody to the spring arrival page, because that provides a lot of different detail on a lot of different steps that are necessary. So to answer the general question, the start of the spring student housing agreement is actually January 9th. However, given the rest of what I'm about to tell you is necessary. We have pushed that back to January 8th so that we have the ability to allow students to arrive on Friday the 8th, Saturday the 9th, or Sunday the 10th in preparation for the start of classes on Monday, January 11th. So the process for arrival is, I'm going to start sort of in the order of things that we want people to do. First, if a student is new to campus, we want to make sure that they have secured their student ID. So they would go to the ID website and submit their photo so that when it is that they arrive on campus, that a photo ID is going to be waiting for them. So all of that they can take care of at this time so that those IDs are ready and available for them. So that's a good thing to just check off your list. The second thing would be to have discussions with whoever it may be helping you with your move-in for the spring semester. And this is both new students that have not lived in housing before and students that are returning to housing. All students, all residential students, will need to go to make an appointment as to when it is that they are going to arrive on campus. And again, those appointment times will have three different check-in locations, and there are plenty of appointment times in each of those days. And those are actually appointment times for students to come to those check-in locations. And the reason that we're doing that, one, is to sort of control the flow, similar to what we did in the fall, so that we don't have everybody arriving at the same time. We can try to maintain our social distancing. But probably most importantly, what it allows us to do is to administer a nasal PCR test. It's a self-swab that will be required before the students are able to move into their residence hall. And so they should make an appointment. And as they prepare to arrive on campus, the first thing that they do is to go to one of the check-in locations. They'll take their PCR test, which is COVID test, and then they will be permitted to move into housing.
Great. We have a question about that particular process from Laura, a Facebook viewer. For returning students, can they submit a negative COVID test instead of doing one on move-in day?
No, the requirement is that they participate in the COVID testing that is happening on site. And this is different than the process that we used in the fall semester. And the reason that we're doing it's based on guidance that we've received from the public health professionals and the medical professionals on staff, is that we want to make sure that we're testing sort of real time. And it's the snapshot that we're, and we all know that testing is a snapshot in time. And so what we're trying to do is we're trying to assess the status of people as they have arrived on campus. And so there's no need for students to find their own testing offsite. There's no reason that they need to submit their own test in advance for that process. They just arrive, we'll have the testing that's available, and then they'll be able to move into the halls.
Thank you. And so we just went through everything they need to do ahead of time. So thank you for that thorough overview of all the different steps, which also are included in that webpage that I've posted. So you can make sure that you've checked everything off as you prepare for your spring arrival. Where are the check-in locations? So if you go and you sign up for your check-in appointment time, where are students checking in the day of?
Sure. So all of that information is listed on the spring arrival page so that you don't have to remember it, but I will tell you. So we have three locations. I'll start on the south side of campus. So students that live in Juniper Hall, Poplar Hall, or the Magnolia Apartments will go to Juniper Poplar 1317, which is one of the multi-purpose rooms that we have in Juniper Poplar. And so all the residents from that, from those three communities will go to that location. Anybody that lives in the Village, which is made up of Beacon Hall, Pinnacle Hall, Horizon, Summit, or Endeavor Hall. So anybody that's in the Village will go to Holly L. And so that is where they'll do their testing and their check-in location. Again, this is for new students as well as returning students. Okay. Anybody that is in any of the other communities, Cypress Apartments, Kosovo Apartments, Beta, Castor, Maple, or Holly Apartments will go to Holly J. And Holly J is located right on the main Holly Drive, pretty close. I think it's just one building off from where the Holly Mail Center is. So, so those are the three locations. They're centrally located in the communities that they are serving.
Great, thank you, Anna. We have a couple questions going back to testing.
Sure.
So the first question is from Lynn, who's watching on Facebook. How soon will the PCR test results be available after taking it on site?
Thanks, Lynn. We have an arrangement with an offsite lab that is going to be processing those tests fairly quickly. We will get the results back within 48 hours. If somebody has tested positive, then they will be contacted. Otherwise, we're not going to be contacting people who have tested negative. What we will be asking students as they have as they're waiting for the results, we're asking students to limit their activity and limit their exposure to the extent possible to only essential activities, basically moving in, getting meals, et cetera, until they get their test results back. If it is that a test result comes back positive, then the student would need to go through the isolation protocol that we have been using throughout the semester. So they would relocate into one of our isolation locations if it is that they weren't able to safely go home to isolate. But the short answer is 48 hours is what our expectation of the test results coming back.
And that your response also answered Laura's question on Facebook. Also, what happens if a student tests positive? Do they have to go straight to quarantine? So that isolation process you mentioned, there is information on our website about that as well. And I can drop that frequently asked question list onto the comments as well.
Sure. We also, as part of our isolation protocol, just so that to try to give a fuller picture, is that we will also do some exposure analysis. And so trying to understand, okay, we've asked you to sort of limit your exposure, but if it is that you've tested positive, we are going to be asking who have you been within 6 feet for more than 15 minutes over the course of the last 48 hours or since you tested, so that we can then go to those individuals who also may be impacted, and close contacts also are required to isolate on our campus. I'm sorry, are also required to isolate. They have the option to isolate off campus at home if that's what they prefer, but they will be required to not be in the residence hall that they're currently assigned to.
And Laura, as a follow-up question to the isolation process, if a resident moves in and then is limiting their activity but in the room with their roommate, potentially they could be exposing their roommate. So in the process that you just explained, we would analyze the situation and see if that roommate also would potentially need to go into isolation based on that. Is that correct?
Yes. Yes. And the we is not Housing and Residential Education. The we is student health services. So all isolation decisions are made based on the recommendations of our medical director at Student Health Services.
Thank you. And also, I mean, needless to say, I would hope that if anyone is not feeling well, thinks that they have any symptoms, obviously, that they would not be coming to campus and get tested separately. So just throwing that out there, that I would hope that would be the first call to make.
Absolutely. Yes. If anybody knows that they have tested positive or been exposed to a positive case within 14 days of their arrival on campus, they should not come to campus until that quarantine period has ended. So, but before they arrive on campus, we really encourage people to be in touch with their primary health care provider. So when I say that they don't need to get tested before they arrive on campus, that's for the housing requirement to move in. I certainly am not discouraging anybody from getting tested if they are symptomatic or if they have any concerns about their exposure prior to arriving on campus.
Thank you for that clarification too. A follow-up question from Lynn. Will the isolation protocol that we have set in place on campus be updated to align with the new CDC guidelines?
So the isolation protocol at USF will remain the same as we have been practicing over the course of the this semester, which is that students would be required to isolate for 10 days if they test positive. And if it is that they are asked to isolate due to exposure, it would be 14 days from the last contact with the positive case. So we have done that based on our medical professionals consultation and our public health professionals consultation with the CDC to better understand the changes that were made to those guidelines. And it was geared towards very specific populations and people in very specific roles. And because the risk of exposure has not changed, right? It still remains that 14-day period. That is what we're going to continue to adhere to at USF.
Thank you, Anna. And then one other question before we move forward with the other spring opening information from Christine watching on Facebook. My son has a roommate, but the room next door, which is a suite style, is empty. Is there a reason? Are we keeping singles available? Is that why that room is open?
So we have spaces that are available, and we call them super singles. So it's basically a double room that a student has requested to have as their own. So if it is that there's an empty room next to the room that your son and his roommate is in, that could be that we would be accommodating two new people that would arrive. It could be that it will be sold as a super single. If it is that either your son or his roommate are interested in a super single so that they can secure that they have their own space, they should contact housing at usf.edu, and we're happy to accommodate that. So we've been trying to be pretty flexible. So if students, we have students that definitely wanted to make sure that they had a roommate, because one of the reasons they moved on campus was to be able to have that connection and the community. And so they keep that small pod with their roommate and some close friends. And then there are others that feel much more comfortable if they have their own space. And so we want to make sure that both of those options are available. And we're happy to work with anybody who may have changed their mind. So we made that offer available for students in the fall. And then we renewed that for students that were in doubles to let us know before we opened up for new students to select the rooms. But if it is that somebody has changed their mind and they'd feel more comfortable in a super single, we're happy to work with them and try to find out what options are available.
Great, thank you. So we've gone through, I'm looking through my questions now. We've gotten some great questions from viewers that have taken a lot of the questions that I have prepared. We do have some additional questions not related to spring opening from the audience that I can get to as well. Glenda is asking on Facebook about super singles. And Glenda is asking about the most isolated room type that is available on campus. So could you review what a super single means and what the most independent living style on campus would look like?
Sure. So what a super single means, that's the language that we use, is a room that typically is assigned to two students to share that space. That can be as part of a suite style. It can be a part of a traditional room. We have a couple of double apartments, but let's put those aside. And so what a super single would do is that room that traditionally is assigned to two people would only be assigned to one person. So again, that can happen in a variety of different building types. So you could have a super single in one of our traditional halls, which means that you would have your own bedroom, but the bathroom facility that you would be sharing would still be a community bathroom. You could have a super single in a suite style, say Juniper Poplar or Maple Suites, where you could have your own room and then there's an adjoining bathroom, and the person that you share a bathroom with either can be in a super single as well, so it's two of you sharing that bathroom, or it could be that there are two other people in that room, so the three of you would share that bathroom, okay? You would have your own sink area or vanity area in your individual bedroom, but that's sort of how that space would be shared. The other single option, which is a regular design configuration, is a single bedroom in an apartment. And so most of our apartments are four-bedroom apartments. So you would have your own single bedroom, and three other people would also have their single bedroom. And then there are two bathrooms that are located in those apartments, a common living room and a common kitchen. So four people would share that whole apartment. There are two bathrooms, and so you have your own bedroom, but you are still sharing some of those facilities. The most private, most isolated room that we have on campus would be a super single suite in the Village. And so that's, again, Beacon, Endeavor, Pinnacle, Horizon, or Summit. And what that configuration is it's a double room, but it has a bathroom contained within that room. And so if it is a super single, there would only be one person in the bedroom, and they would be the only ones that have access to that bathroom. So that would be the most isolated space that we have on campus.
Thank you, Anna. And I've dropped the link directly to go review all of the different housing types. So the link that I've provided, you can review all of the apartment styles, all of the traditional, and all of the suite styles that are available on campus. So you can definitely do some exploring on our website and our YouTube page. There's great videos on there that walk you through the rooms and really give you a feel for what the on-campus experience is like. So definitely take a look at our website for that information. So I'm going to go through some additional questions that we have here from the audience that's apart from the spring opening. When it comes to room selection, Glenda is asking about transfer students. So Glenda is a transfer student with their AA, so technically not a first time in college student, but new to USF. So does their order for selecting a room change, or are they in the same group as the FTIC?
So with regard to room selection, the dividing line is basically whether you're a current USF student or a new USF student. And so transfer students and new first time in college students would be in that category where they would be able to start their selection on March 10th. But students have access, and so I want to make sure that from an assignments perspective or from a community perspective, there is not a requirement that a transfer student goes into a hall that may be primarily first time in college students. Transfer students can live with other upperclassmen, sophomores, juniors, seniors that live on campus. We have apartment style options, and so that is an option that some of our transfer students prefer. There's just a different level of privacy. They like to have their own kitchen, whatever that may be. We also have transfer students who really have never had a traditional college experience. And so they are really interested in being in a very active, suite style environment. They want to be in a place where they can meet more people because they maybe have not had an on-campus experience before. So really the choice is yours with regard to what you think best fits your living style that you're looking for, or the area of a campus. Sometimes students select a certain area of campus because they want to be closer to their academic buildings, or they want to be closer to the Marshall Student Center or the library or campus rec, whatever that may be. So the options are yours with regard to which room you select, but the answer to the question is that it's aligned with being a new student. So March 10th would be the time that you would be able to select. And this is for fall and summer. If we have a transfer student, and if Glenda's planning on coming in for the spring semester, we love that. We can get you an assignment right away so that it's ready for you in January.
Thank you, Anna. And Margo has a question about the housing agreement. So her question is, do you need to sign a binding agreement to put a deposit on housing for fall 2021?
So there's an application fee, which is a $50 application fee. Then as part of that application process, you're signing and agreeing to a student housing contract for the 2021-2022 academic year. Okay, so yes, you would need to pay the application fee and you enter into a binding agreement. However, prior to May 1st, you are able to cancel that agreement without any penalty. The $50 application fee is non-refundable, but through, again, this is a fall, this is the fall and the summer term that I'm talking about. There wouldn't be any penalty if you canceled your student housing agreement before May 1st. And then after May 1st, then there's a graduated cancellation fee until we open up. And then there's only specific reasons that you would be permitted to cancel the housing agreement. Things like military service, if you get married between the time you sign your contract and the time that you move in, if you're withdrawing from enrollment at USF, medical withdrawal, or if you transferred out, there are several limitations with regard to how it is or when it is you may be able to cancel a student housing agreement for the fall or the summer. And so I would want everybody that is considering living on campus to make sure that they're reading the full student housing agreement. And then if they have any questions, they certainly can reach out to us. So, but there isn't a separate deposit that needs to be made. There is the $50 application fee.
Thank you. And a question from Anne, who's watching on Facebook. What is the last day for moving out of the residence halls in May?
Ooh,
thinking ahead. I have the calendar up here, and the spring residence hall closing, we have listed as May 7th.
May 7th, okay.
Mm-hmm. That's a Friday.
I will take Julia as the resource because I didn't have that date off the top of my head. So,
it would be
noon on Friday, May 7th. Again, students are expected to move out within 24 hours of their last final.
Great,
but
thank you.
May 7th would be the end date.
Thank you. And a viewer on Microsoft Teams, welcome to our Teams live chat here, is asking about ventilation in the halls. It's a topic that they said has had a lot of discussion surrounding it. And if you could provide any information about that in the halls and in the different protocols and efforts that are in place to make sure that we're mitigating the spread of COVID-19.
Sure. So we work very closely with our Department of Environmental Health and Safety. And so they have reviewed all of the facilities that we have on campus. And we are adhering to the protocols that they have recommended with regard to the increased cleaning and the chemicals that we're using and how it is that we would treat a space if it is that presence of COVID was detected. I think you also know that we do environmental testing, but for the ventilation system, we haven't changed our ventilation system in the residence halls or the apartments that we have here, but we do regular filter changes, and we've increased the frequency of the filter changes since March when COVID was really really became a presence on the forefront of everybody's mind. So the existing ventilation systems that we have are still in place, but we have increased our frequency and our preventive maintenance on that equipment.
Great. Thank you, Anna. And for those that are joining us that might not know about the environmental testing, I know that it's been a topic of discussion that we've had throughout everything, and you've been, you know, really on the front lines there, assisting and supporting and managing that effort. Can you go over it a little bit just for those that might not be aware of that process?
Sure, sure. My family lovingly calls me the swab queen now. So, and I'll tell you why that is. So the environmental testing process is one of our mitigation strategies so that we can identify the presence of the virus early in order to then try to identify people who may have been in that space, and then we do follow-up testing. So the environmental testing is one of those randomized testing that we do in our university population, and then our very active isolation and quarantine protocol, along with all of our face mask wearing, washing your hands, 6 feet distancing. So all of those things together try to help us create a healthy environment. But specifically, I use my show and tell, is for the environmental testing. What we do is we take a swab. This is just a sort of like a Q-tip with a sponge on the end of it. We use this and we swab high touch surfaces throughout the residence hall. So that may be light switches or doorknobs, elevator buttons, the backs of chairs, so where you grab a chair to pull it in or pull it out or push it in, tabletops, etc. We've done microwave buttons, we've done refrigerators, we've done faucet handles, so basically high touch areas. So we swab the high touch areas. We may swab 5 or 6 surfaces, and then we return the swab to the test tube. We do about 100 of these tests a week, so 500 different surfaces over the course of the week in a variety of different residence halls throughout campus. We then work with lab on campus, and they are able to put this through the machine, do the assessment, and what they can do is they can test whether or not there is the presence of the COVID-19 virus that has been detected in any of these swabs. If that is the case, they let us know where that is, so which test tube it came from. And then what we're able to do is we can do some follow-up testing with students that may be on that floor or in that building. And then we would test the students in that building, because basically a positive presence of COVID means that at some time, somebody that had the virus and was shedding the virus was in that space, okay? Doesn't mean that the space wasn't cleaned. It doesn't mean that that there's a problem in the building. It's just that it helps us to identify where there may be somebody that could be asymptomatic, because we know a lot of students in this age range are not sick. And so they don't present symptoms, but they may be carrying the virus. And so this just helps us identify that in asymptomatic people more quickly.
Great, thank you. And we have gotten through all of our questions from our viewers. So thank you everyone for all of your wonderful questions. And I will be sharing the information for our housing assignments team for if you have any additional questions for us. We would love to hear from you either over email or phone. But before we wrap tonight, Anna, going back to spring opening. Sure. Is there anything else students and families should keep in mind or do to prepare for a successful spring opening experience, not only for them, but for everyone else involved?
Sure. And before I forget, I do want to mention one other thing that I forgot to mention. I had talked about the housing contract beginning on January 9th. That's the same for the dining contract, but we've worked with our dining colleagues, and because we're going to be starting our move-in process on Friday, January 8th, the dining contracts will also begin at that time. So I want to make sure that nobody has any concern that if they arrive a day before or they arrive on the 8th, that the services won't be available. So I just wanted to let you know that dining is aligned with our strategy with regard to the arrivals on campus. The question that you had, I'm sorry, was if there was anything else that they needed to know about
anything they need to know or to help prepare them or their family members for a successful spring move-in.
Sure. So I think that really taking a look at the appointment times, making the appointment for their move-in, you know, as early as possible so that they can then start making their plans, whether that's travel plans, plane reservations, et cetera. I would say try not to bring, you know, everything that you own into your space. It's still, you know, a small space and, you know, we're trying to emphasize students keeping their spaces, you know, clean, neat and tidy. And that's really helpful, especially as there's increased cleaning and disinfecting that students are doing in their own space to stay safe. As they are thinking about who it is that may be joining them on campus, if it is that they're able to move in on their own, that would be great, just so that we can limit the number of people that are on campus. If it is that we have somebody that has a family that wants to come with them, because this is their first time at USF, they want to come to Tampa, whatever the circumstances are, if it is that we can limit the number of people that are going to help in the building, right? So if you can move in and then meet your family for lunch, that's even better. If it is that you need help actually getting the stuff from your car into your room, then we want you to limit that to no more than two people. And we're asking that you complete that move within the time appointment window that you have. We know some people are going to take a little longer, but we're just trying to be respectful of everybody else that is in the hall and everybody that's trying to maintain their social distancing. So in preparation, I would say have some of those conversations so that everybody knows what the role is that people will be playing when they arrive on campus. Everybody knows that's coming in your party that there's an expectation that people are going to be wearing masks. There's an expectation of social distancing, that we want to make sure that people who are maybe immunization compromised or have any underlying medical issues, there's no reason to expose yourself to a large group of people that you don't know are not in your immediate pod. So I would say think about who it is that you're bringing on campus, why you're bringing them on campus, and making sure that everybody's sort of aligned with your expectations and our expectations about adhering to the guidelines on campus. I think that the other thing that would be helpful, and it's not really the logistics of moving in, but most students are going to be sharing space with somebody else. And so if you're new to campus and or if you are a returner to campus and you see that there's somebody new that's moving into your apartment or into your room, reach out to them over the course of the next month, right? Their contact information is available in the housing portal. Make those connections with each other. People have become much more comfortable with virtual connections. Do a Zoom call. Even if it is that you just want to do a chat or whatever it is, try to get to know people, you know, ahead of time. That's always great, a great way to either welcome people or to find out about who you may be sharing space with. So, and, you know, there may be an opportunity for you to build that relationship before you arrive on campus. So that's what I would say. You know, there's the logistics part of moving in, but then there's also the preparation for the spring semester. One of the other things, excuse me, that I'll mention, because we mentioned it back in the fall, but there are new students that may not have heard all of the messages, is we know that students don't expect that they are going to become COVID positive, and they don't expect that they're going to be a close contact of somebody that's COVID positive. But we also know that it happens. And so what we want to do is we want students to be able to have those conversations with their families about, if it is that I need to go into isolation, what are the expectations about communication? Will I stay on campus? Will I come home? What does that look like? And also, if there is anything that you would want in isolation, if you're on campus, we sort of say an isolation to-go bag, right? So you have very limited window to prepare to be in a space and outside of your room for 2 weeks. And so, you know, is there medication that you want to bring? you know, this, it's going to sound funny, but I'm a mom, so I get to say this, is if you want to bring an extra, you know, dozen pair of underwear, that's always a good thing to have, right? Because not all students don't always do their laundry on a regular basis. And, you know, believe it or not, that's one of those things that they're like, how can I go into isolation? I don't have any clean underwear. So, you know, from a mom, bring some clean underwear. So, but whatever else is comfort, you know, comfort food, if there are hobbies that you have, you know, crossword puzzles or Sudoku or whatever it is that you may do that helps pass time in isolation, just think about that. You know, everybody thinks that they're not going to go in, but if they do, you know, then we want them to be as comfortable as possible.
That's great advice. Thank you, Anna. And thank you for all of that advice too, with the reaching out to your roommate, I think is really important. You know, there's a lot of virtual opportunities to connect right now. And I think that getting to know your future roommate, even if it is over, like you said, a Zoom call or text messaging, whatever it may be, I think that that's definitely important and something to keep in mind when you're preparing for your spring experience. So we've gotten through all the questions. I really appreciate your time tonight, Anna, and I appreciate everyone that's watching on social media or here with us on Teams. Thank you so much for all of your great questions. And I am going to just provide just a couple of reminders before we wrap tonight. Be sure to review the fall closing and spring opening webpage on our website. I've dropped all those links on wherever you're watching tonight. And the fall spring 2021-22 application is live in the housing portal. And our next live show is going to be on Wednesday, January 6th at 6 p.m. We're going to be reviewing all of the spring opening information and whatever housing questions you may have with Dr. Andy Johnson from Housing. So if you have any additional questions that we didn't cover tonight, or if you think of anything else, you can always email us at housing@usf.edu or call us at 813-974-0001. So until next time, go Bulls. Have a great night, everyone, and thank you, Anna.
You're welcome. Go Bulls.